Tēnā koutou katoa and welcome to the annual climate summary for 2021. My name is NIWA and I'm one of the co-authors for the summary this year alongside my colleague Gregor Makara. So just a few housekeeping things before we get started. For our journalists in the room, you're welcome to ask questions at the end of this presentation, and I will be answering the questions on our live stream as well. And for those joining us online, welcome. You can ask questions as well. Feel free to pop them in the comments. I will be taking questions at the end for online comments as well. But if you happen to watch this after the fact, we will also answer your questions at a later date. Okay, so to get started, I thought I'd start with temperature. There's been some speculation already online, was it our warmest year on record? And in order to assess this question, what we do is we look at how the average temperature for 2021 compares using the NIWA 7 station series, which is a long running record extending back to 1909. And I forgot to mention here that I will be going through a story map, and this story map will in fact be available online for people to look through themselves, and there are some interactive graphics in there, so I do encourage you to explore for yourself. So with no further ado, temperature. So 2021 was in fact our warmest year on record, I can now confirm that, and the average temperature for 2021 was 13.56 degrees. So that means that we surpassed our previous record, which was set in 2016. This long-running record shows that New Zealand's average annual temperature has increased by about 1 degree over the past 100 years. If we have a look at the seven station series plotted as what we call anomalies, we can see how the annual temperature compares to a long-term average. And so we're using a baseline to compare how that temperature compares to the average. Meteorological agencies around the world generally use a 30-year baseline to put our climate into context. And this allows climate statistics from different countries around the world to be compared. For this year's annual climate summary, we are using the 1981 to 2010 30-year reference period. In the graph, red bars indicated years that experienced above average temperatures, and as you would expect, blue bars indicate years that experienced below average temperatures. We can see 2016 on this graph, that recorded an average temperature of 13.45 degrees or 0.84 degrees above average, which was New Zealand's warmest year on record at the time. However, in 2021, we finished with an average temperature of 13.56 degrees, which was 0.95 degrees above average and became New Zealand's new warmest year on record. During 2022, NIWA will transition to using the most recent 1991 to 2020 reference period when we're referring to temperature anomalies in climate summaries like this one. Using this warmer reference period, the 2021 annual average temperature would be considered 0.82 degrees above average. And for the purposes of historical comparison, the World Meteorological Organization recommends using the 1961 to 1990 period for calculating global climate anomalies. And when comparing to this 30-year average, the 2021 average temperature would be 1.09 degrees above average. So if you're still with me, what this means is that the temperature itself does not change regardless of which reference period we use. It is just the anomaly value. The ranking also does not change. Our warmest year on record remains the warmest year on record despite which reference period we use. And as maybe a bit of an analogy, if NIWA was paying me $10 an hour, then and the minimum wage was $5 an hour, I'd be earning $5 an hour more than the minimum wage. If the minimum wage increased to $8 an hour, I'd be earning $2 an hour more than the minimum wage, but I'd still be going home with $10 for an hour of work. So it's the same kind of thing here. We're not changing the temperatures, we're not changing the rankings, but the reference period it does change, and we update it every 10 years. And I guess no matter which way you slice it, 7 of the past 9 years have been amongst New Zealand's warmest on record, despite which reference period you use. We can also look at monthly temperatures, so not just for the year as a whole. If we use the seven station series to look at how temperatures varied by month, we can see that 3 months of 2021 featured what we consider near average temperatures, which is within half a degree of average. And those were January, February and September. So a relatively cool start to the year. Obviously this was summer, but for the time of year, it was cooler when compared to the rest of the months of the year, when in fact the remaining 9 months of the year featured above average temperatures. And during 2021, there were no months that experienced below average temperatures. As we can see from the map, not every single month was quite as warm as the other. There are regional differences, even some areas that may have been a little bit cooler, and that's what is expected when we're looking at regional differences like this. Another way that we can look at temperatures is by looking at daily temperatures. How did every day of 2021 compare to, I guess, that time of year? And we can use the virtual climate station network to assess this. If we look at daily temperatures, what we see is that 26%, oh, I've skipped too far, 26% of days experienced below average or well below average temperatures. So that's at least half a degree lower than average. I'll be patient now, not scroll as fast. 19% of days experienced near average temperatures. There we go. 55% of days experienced above average or well above average temperatures. So that's at least half a degree warmer than average for the day. So no matter which way you slice it, the year, the month or daily data, we can see that we had quite a lot of warmth during 2021. And the hottest spell of the year took hold at the start of the year from the 25th to 28th of January, where several locations observed record or near record high daily maximum temperatures, so a hot day, or record high daily minimum temperatures, so a warm night. Let's have a look here. So our highest temperature for 2021 was recorded on the 26th of January, and that was in Ashburton. And the maximum temperature there reached 39.4 degrees, which was New Zealand's second highest January temperature on record. And it was also the country's 10th equals hottest temperature on record, and that's for all months. So quite a high temperature there. On May 27th, temperature at Dunedin Airport, so this down here, so I'm saying you can explore the story map online yourself. Dunedin Airport dropped to On May 27th, the temperature at Dunedin Airport dropped to minus 8.8 degrees overnight. And this was the equal lowest temperature on record, with records extending back to 1962 there. So this was actually the only location to experience a record or near record cold temperature in 2021. And there were in fact no locations that experienced a record or near record cold daytime temperature in 2021. There was actually a recent study by NIWA that found in the last decade there were on average 4 to 5 times more extreme high temperatures than would be expected in a climate with no long-term warming. Switching gears to rainfall now, the start of the year featured quite a bit of dryness, and in particular meteorological drought based on New Zealand's drought index, which is the animation that we're seeing on screen here. We did see meteorological drought develop in the far north for a while during January. Very dry to extremely dry conditions based on this index became widespread across large parts of the North Island, as well as Marlborough and Northern Canterbury during February. There were water restrictions for a time in Northland, Auckland, the Wairarapa and the Hastings District. Now, while 2021 featured extended dry spells owing to frequent high pressure, there were also several extreme rainfall events. Many of these are detailed in our monthly climate summaries as well as in the annual climate summary itself. Here I'm just showing some of the most notable ones. From the 29th to 31st of May, a prolonged and heavy rainfall event struck Canterbury, with severe flooding occurring in many eastern foothill areas. Damage caused by flooding was widespread, and hundreds of residents from several settlements were forced to evacuate, including the entire town of Springfield. There was research done after the event carried out by the URAM project, and that found that the extreme rainfall associated with this event was 10 to 15% more intense as a result of human influences on the climate system. From the 15th to 18th of July, a pulse of tropical air deriving from the Indian Ocean combined with an upper level trough to direct a humid and gusty northerly flow. The event led to flows at the Buller River reaching flow rates higher than ever recorded in any New Zealand river, and residents in parts of Westport, which we're seeing here, were forced to evacuate as the Buller River burst its banks, leaving a waist high water in many areas. Floodwaters also cut off parts of Marlborough, and nearly 1,000 people had to evacuate. The flooding resulted in an estimated $132.4 million in privately insured damage, and that's according to the New Zealand Insurance Council, and that includes the West Coast, Marlborough, as well as parts of Wellington that were affected by this extreme rainfall event. At the end of August, a soil load pressure system led to near record rainfall over northwestern Auckland. Considerable flooding was reported in some areas, including Kumu and Ranui, with an evacuation centre set up for approximately 60 households, forcing them to leave their home. Now, this is an interesting event as it was quite localised and compared to the Canterbury and the Westport flooding, not very widespread. However, it was in fact, when looking at the flooding events during 2021, the second costliest in terms of insured damage behind the Westport flooding, and I guess owing to the urban nature of this event. And in November, a slow-moving subtropical low caused persistent heavy rainfall and affected the eastern North Island and brought flooding and slips to parts of Gisborne. A search and rescue squad used boats to evacuate residents from flooded homes. In less than one day, Gisborne received more rainfall than it did during the entire summer of 2020 to 2021. So out of the events I just described, three of the flooding events resulted in state of emergency declarations, and this was the Canterbury flooding, the West Coast and Upper South Island Wellington flooding in July, as well as the Gisborne flooding in November. And atmospheric river events commonly flow down toward New Zealand, driving precipitation extremes such as like this. And we're seeing in this image some of the atmospheric moisture, and you can see really clearly see the tropical connection that was present during these extreme rainfall events. With the exception of February and March, every other month of the year had at least one location experience their wettest day on record. And we've plotted some of these records on a map, which viewers can look at themselves and explore that in their own time. Let's now chat about some of the climate drivers that led to our record warm year. Everybody wants to know the why, and as is often the case, there were several climate drivers in 2021 that influenced our climate. Now, La Niña was one such key climate driver. During January and February, we had moderate La Niña conditions in the Central Pacific, and that event actually began in October 2020. But during the start of the year, those La Niña conditions eased, and the impacts on weather patterns from the climate driver at the start of the year were actually generally not consistent with those typically expected, which likely owed in part to a non-traditional variety of La Niña. I'm going to scan upwards a bit. Let's come back to that. So you may recall when we looked at the monthly temperature anomalies, January and February were actually some of our cooler months. So in a La Niña, we typically get more northeasterlies and warmer temperatures, and that was not the case at the start of the year, which is what I meant by kind of atypical impacts. However, in autumn 2021, we had long dry spells and warmth interspersed by bursts of heavy rainfall. And this was because La Niña waned and the dominant climate driver became the Madden-Julian oscillation, which is an eastward moving pulse of cloud and rain in the tropics. Redeveloping La Niña conditions during spring resulted in a transition from a westerly airflow, near average temperatures and widespread wet weather during September to more northeasterly winds during October and December, more typical for a La Niña. bringing frequent warm and humid weather and contributing to the country's fifth warmest October, our warmest November, and our fourth warmest December on record. Sticking with the theme of coastal waters, now I talked about La Nina, and that's actually cooler water in the Pacific, but and for our part of the world in Aotearoa New Zealand, La Nina is often actually associated with warm coastal waters, and we, as you can see from this animation here, there's a lot of red colours on the map indicating for large parts of the year we had above average coastal sea surface temperatures, and in particular it was a very warm end to the year in our oceans. We had during December, daily sea surface temperatures reached as high as 4 to 5 degrees above average around western and northern North Island, and this qualified as one of the strongest marine heatwave events in the last four decades in the North Island's coastal waters. So as being an island nation, being surrounded by seas, having warm ocean waters around us certainly aids warm temperatures on land as well, which is why this was a key contributor to our warm year. Another climate indicator that we can look at is the southern annular mode. So the southern annular mode is an indicator of southern hemisphere climate variability, and this was positive in this positive phase, I should say, for 73% of time during 2021. The positive SAM phase is associated with higher than normal air pressure around New Zealand, which tends to bring more tranquil weather conditions to the country. And sticking with that theme of high pressure and tranquil conditions, if we look at how our air pressure for the year as a whole compares to average, what we see is that we had high pressure over and particularly to the east of the country, and the airflow anomaly, or there were more northeasterly winds than usual. Now, as you can imagine, winds coming from the north and east, they're coming from a warm place, and that was also a contributor to our warmer climate in 2021. A lot of the things I've just talked about are kind of, they all kind of come together, having settled weather and high pressure that goes hand in hand with a positive SAM phase. That also means that our coastal waters aren't getting churned up and mixed, so there's more chance for them to warm up, and La Nina as well is often associated with more northeasterly. So all of these kind of climate drivers are actually in tandem. And on top of that, we've already talked about the elephant in the room and climate change in large parts of this presentation. And of course, that is also an influence in any weather event really, but for our record warm year as well. So this is the picture here is the annual temperature anomalies for the globe. And if we look at that, we can see that in 2021, 77% of the planet experienced above average temperatures relative to that 1981 to 2010 baseline. Today, actually, it was announced that this was the Earth's fifth warmest year on record, so warmest in our part of the world, for the globe as a whole, fifth warmest year on record, and the last 7 years have been the warmest on record. Now, I'll note that we have, when there is a La Nina, which we can see by those blue colours in the Pacific there, often those are some of our cooler years for the globe as a whole, because La Nina brings upwelling of cooler water from deeper below, and so having that kind of part of the ocean with below average temperatures, we typically don't experience globally the warmest year on record. But despite La Nina, we can see that we still had a record warmth in New Zealand and also other parts of the world as well. Those are our key climate drivers for 2021. I do like to end on a slightly brighter note, and it is the sunshine races. So it's a very contested battle every year. Who wins the sunshine crown for 2021? And in fact, the result for last year was very interesting. Taranaki won the sunshine crown with 2,592 hours of sunshine recorded in 2021. So that was Taranaki was our sunniest region, and those hours were recorded at the climate station in New Plymouth. What I found interesting as we were compiling the annual climate summary is, in fact, in 2020, so the year prior, New Plymouth actually recorded 8 hours more sunshine than last year. The reason that it won the crown this year was not because it was unusually sunny, but it was because the usual top three contenders, which are the Bay of Plenty, Nelson and Marlborough, were in fact less sunny than usual, so a little bit cloudier than usual. So they didn't quite get their sunshine hours, and that allowed New Plymouth or Taranaki to take the sunshine crown. So that's kind of a wrap up. We do have a summary of some of the key numbers for 2021 here. This is just really skimming the surface of what's in the annual climate summary document itself. All of the facts and figures, which locations around the country had their hottest year, any other records broken, all inside the document. So have a look there, and the story map is available to explore as well.